following presentation of Cinema Then, Cinema Now is made possible in part by a grant from the Japan Foundation, New York office. Welcome to Cinema Then, Cinema Now, the film series with lively discussion. I'm your host, Jerry Carlson, and I teach cinema studies at the College of Staten Island of the City University of New York. Today, we continue our five-week series, Classics of Postwar Japanese Cinema. We'll be seeing the searing, visually stunning anti-war film directed by Kon Ichikawa, Fires on the Plain. It's set during the Japanese retreat across the Philippines in 1945. We'll be talking about this as an anti-war film, as a visually very impressive film, and a set of other things after today's screening. It's a pleasure to have with us the distinguished American film director and writer, Paul Schrader. Now, enjoy the moving Fires on the Plain. Welcome back to Cinema Then, Cinema Now. I hope you've enjoyed this, I think, extremely rare opportunity to see a film such as Kon Ichikawa's Fires on the Plain. There's a lot to talk about this film, and also it brings up a whole set of issues about Japanese culture, our relationship to it, etc., etc. And we've got 30 minutes to chat about a few of those episodes. Today, it's a pleasure to have with us Paul Schrader, well known as a film director, and author of scripts such as Taxi Driver, Raging Bull. Paul is also, of course, a distinguished director himself. Recent films include The Comfort of Strangers, Light Sleeper. Some people may or may not remember that he's also Dr. Paul Schrader because he took a doctorate in cinema studies many years ago and has the work that came out of that is The Transcendental Style, Brisson, Dreyer, and Ozu, a very significant book on Japanese cinema. And only one more thing, two of his films have a very significant relationship to Japan. Your first sold script, I think, The Yakuza, set in the gangster world of Japan, and then the remarkable Mishima about the great Japanese author. Let's start with this, because you know a great deal about film genres, Paul. Let's start with this, and this is a war film. How do you think this film fits in with the general genre of war film, and also with the way the Japanese have handled it?
Well, it would be in the subcategory of war film, anti-war film.
Yeah, right.
You know, I think there's something to be said that the anti-war film probably is a category of the war film.
Mm-hmm.
This is the argument that the Soviets used in attacking Platoon, which they said you can't have an anti-war film with American production values because it ends up being a war film.
No. Yes.
I was on a jury in Berlin when that debate before the fall of the wall and all of that, and the Soviets were very adamant that Platoon was not an anti-war film.
Because of that whole attraction of the image and of the action.
Yeah, yeah. But so maybe anti-war films are war films, but I'm not sure about that. Anyway, this one is, I think, really quite extraordinary, and I just saw it again, on tape. But I saw it when I was in college, so that was a long time ago. And it really stood out because I'm not quite sure whether the adjective is surreal or existential, but there's something very...
Not mutually exclusive.
Yeah. but it's almost like, and this would fit because of the time period, there's a kind of a Camus and Sartre quality to it, which is this kind of life after death, this wandering, these zombie people personified by this guy, Tanaka, the soldier,
yes.
You know, just sort of drifting in this kind of netherworld where it's neither war nor peace, it's neither life nor death, and it's full of these extraordinary images, you know, where the man says, stick around, you can eat me. You know?
And, as deadpan, but as horrifying as you can get.
Yeah, and there's another image in the film I remember where a man is lying face down, dead in water, and Tanaka stumbles across him and says something, and the man lifts his head up and said, "What was that?" and drops his head back down again.
Right.
And, and those images really hold up. There are some sort of cliched images, like the boot montage, you know, that don't seem so clever anymore.
Yeah.
Maybe they never did. The film, apart from isolated things like that, holds up extremely well. Although I think I should point out, the tape you sent me, which may have a bearing to the tape that was just shown.
Yes, they are from the same source. I must tell the truth.
Sliced off. I mean, when I first saw this film had a wonderful widescreen ratio.
Yes, I know. That is this is one of the constant threats to a programmer is that it's a real balancing act, and it's worth discussing just for a second because it's a balancing act of materials that within American culture at this moment are not as commonly seen as perhaps they were at other moments. And yet, I must say that I have a regret whenever I acquire a material like that, and I know I'm violating what is the original screen format. Or
particularly
whatever.
Ichikawa Kon, who is one of the Japanese masters of the widescreen format, you know, which was introduced in the 50s in Japan like it was here, you know, in order to combat television.
Right.
And a lot of very strong, and the 50s also happened to be what the Japanese call the Golden Age.
Oh, yes.
Yeah, and so a lot of the films from the Golden Age are made in widescreen. And, it's a pity that you have to sit there watching two noses talking to each other.
No. note is taken. And I should say that certain films, that there has been a tendency in certain films released in some recent years on cassette, notably something like Kurosawa's High and Low, which is one of the great uses of widescreen in a mask print.
Yeah, well, just so people know, when you see the film, Fires on the Plane, there's a lot of headshots in there, but those are not the headshots that we associate with headshots, like this.
Yeah.
Because what he's doing is he has a whole hunk of screen out there.
Right.
And so some of these shots almost look like TV shots because they're just talking heads.
Yes.
But in fact, in widescreen, there's a bunch of other stuff going on.
No. And well, then that's one of the things that I think properly makes not only Ichikawa but this whole golden age of Japanese filmmaking is because their sense of in one sense it's a cliche, but their sense of composition and filling that wide screen with so many things happening simultaneously is just not only visually stunning but narratively engaging and the levels of comment that are made.
I think one of the reasons they felt so comfortable with the widescreen is that a lot of their art, because of the scrolling process, is essentially widescreen art, whether it's horizontal or vertical. And, and a lot of Japanese art where you put a little boat here and a fisherman, and there's nothing on the rest of the screen, but this nothing is what makes the boat work.
That is a correlative to one of the things that another guest on one of these shows was saying about the uses of silence within the structure of Japanese films and of drama. Some of us tend to think of one way of viewing silence is there's nothing happening.
Yeah.
But as one of our other guests had commented at one point, no, silence screams in Japanese culture because it's culturally encoded in different ways. So just as you've got that empty space, so you can have an empty oral space that's doing the same kind of thing. Let's get back just for a second, because I think Platoon is a film that a lot of people are familiar with, and is an extremely interesting contrast. Not necessarily a valuative contrast, but just in how you end up structuring something. Because Platoon is called Platoon. It's got a protagonist, but we follow a lot of people in that film, and a lot of different actions. That differs in a lot of way from the way we're set up in this film, Fires on the Plain.
Well, you know, Platoon, for all of its anti-war qualities, it's basically a dramatic film with an upbeat drive. And Fires on the Plain is deeply melancholy and deeply bleak. You always get in these conundrums when you're trying to protest something.
Right.
Because if you protest it well enough, it's the thing you are protesting.
Right, right.
How do you make an anti-sex movie? I suppose you make sex absolutely unappealing.
Absolutely right.
You know? or do you make no sex at all? You know?
Right.
It's very, and the war film, a lot of films that have gone out under the rubric of anti-war films, in fact, have made their money as being war films.
Oh, yes. Guys charging up the hill and throwing those grenades and all of that.
It's just like the DeMille biblical epics.
Right.
You know, where then you tag on some sort of ending that says it was all right to enjoy those people being blown up because we know war is futile after all. But I think Fires on the Plain is genuinely anti-war because it is so melancholy and so empty and it's so devoid of those pleasures. And I suspect it's probably because it came from a novel.
Yeah.
And one of the reasons it's a little hard to pin down Kon Ichikawa is that I think his best work has been adaptations of major Japanese novels. So that when people think about a director like Ichikawa, they tend to think more in images than in themes because he always used, his best work was from authors who had very strong personalities,
Well, there are some, and I mean this in the best sense, there are some things that in this film that are clearly derived from what is more commonly thought of as a novelistic tradition, because we follow this one soldier, really. I mean, there's a slightly picaresque quality in that he engages with different groups of people while on a journey. But, of course, the film also has these sequences of the interior monologues as well that deeply ally us with him. And you can't get away from this guy. I mean, for almost 2 hours, whatever his experience is, we're going to be a part of it as well.
I never quite thought of it that way. I'm sure that's why it struck me so strongly when I first saw it, because it's the sort of film that I have been interested in, you know, and with the Taxi Driver and...
Exactly. I was just thinking of the loner.
Yeah. And the
obsessive loner.
The Light Sleeper again. And, you know, where you get into one person's... I call them monocular films.
Right.
Where you just, it's like looking at something through a little eye tunnel.
Yeah.
And that's all you see. That's all you see. You do not allow any other correlative in. And eventually, the audience ends up identifying with someone they don't want to identify with because they're given no other choice.
Right.
And once they identify with a character, I hesitate even to call him a hero or a protagonist, but once they identify with a character who they don't regard as worth identification, then they have opened a door inside them, even if it's only a crack. And you can slip all kinds of things in that crack.
Yes, no. No, indeed, and you know, this moves, I mean, in this particular instance, I mean, the principle is dissolution of everything surrounding this character, and so it moves from the more traditional to the less and less traditional. I mean, the longer we're with him, I don't know if the more we care with him, but the more we're just allied with his experience, and by the end, we're having experiences with him that we don't want to have any more than he wants to have, but we're somehow stuck in this pact, in this pact together.
Yeah, it's probably not a terribly good film to be seen on television. And generally, I'm not against television. I'm not against video. All of the directors who would attack video, they were all lying. They all watch video just like everyone else.
Yeah, right, right.
And
there's a video cassette store in everybody's neighborhood.
And you know, if you give them a choice of taking a video home or having to trot down to the theater, they'll watch it at home.
Yeah.
They're like everybody else. But one of the problems with
today's revelation, right?
But one of the problems with this film is that because it works at a relatively minimal level, and is so scaled down in terms of anticipation and effect, that it becomes easy to leave the room and switch the channel, and because you're not being driven,
right,
propelled by the narrative, and once you do that in a film like this, or like an Ozu film or
right,
a Brace film, or once you break it,
right,
then it can never really work on you because it's based on a kind of a cumulative attrition of effect.
Yes. And it's not, I think it's a really strong point because it's not, again, since it's this journey structure, we're not caught up in some kind of tight causal, chain of things. He's going to come across what he comes across. And that will have a cumulative effect.
And when you leave the room, you don't really miss anything. But what you miss is, that saturation.
You know,
it's like if you sit in a tub long enough, your skin will start to wrinkle.
Right.
And if you get out for 10 minutes, you got to start over again. And, and your skin, and it's the same thing with a movie like this.
Yeah. Now, let's talk about that. And do you find that, now, we've been talking about this as this particular film and anti-war film, etc. You spent a lot of time looking at Japanese film, like a lot of other American directors who find it fascinating. Do you find this kind of dramatic structure, for lack of a better phrase, more common to Japanese film, this working by a cumulative effect, or this by accretion in some way?
Well, I think it's the older style. Kurosawa, in some ways, revolutionized Japanese cinema by ratcheting it up to the American pace. Before that, the age of Naruse and Ozu, it was a very much quieter cinema. And in fact, a lot of Japanese have sort of had to come back to Ozu and Naruse because they got sort of mesmerized by Kurosawa. And I do think that this is a relatively unique film in any culture. I don't think this, even the slow pace of Japanese films don't deal with this kind of subject matter.
Okay,
and particularly in this case, this is a far more verboten subject matter in Japan than it is here. I mean, even today, this is not. The Japanese still have a hard time today accepting what the rest of the world knows as fact in terms of the atrocities in the Philippines and Indonesia. And there was a story 2 weeks ago about the union of there used to be slave prostitutes during the war in Korea.
Yes.
And they've sort of formed a group together demanding some sort of government acknowledgement of their existence. And of course, no one really wants to acknowledge their existence, And when you have a communal society that lives by consensus, if there is no consensus, there is no reality.
It's well pointing out that there's another film that actually was had some brief popularity in the United States called Sandokan 8.
Yeah.
Sandokan 8.
I think it was Shinoda, wasn't it?
Yeah, I believe so. It was Shinoda.
It was nominated for Best Film Academy Award.
Yeah, and was very much, again, yeah. one of these muckraking mm-hmm. films about the war, because it's the story of a young university student doing a thesis who goes to interview an yeah. old woman and then uncovers...
Like Sarah the Nasty Girl.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah. Very much the same thing of a code of silence yeah. about an entire historical historical period. Well, this makes this film interesting because it's also, it's worth noting that we're seeing this film, 30 some odd years after it was made,
yeah.
but the distance between the war and this film is only 15 years.
Yeah, and I'm trying to think now. This is 59, right?
Yeah.
When did the occupation end?
The occupation ended in 52, as I understand it. I mean, the withdrawal began around 50 to 52. Mm. It was officially over in 52. Yeah. So this is seven years after that, and 7 years after the yeah. sort of strict governance of the Japanese film industry by the occupation government.
Yeah, no, I don't have these facts at my disposal, but I would be surprised if this film had a great distribution in Japan.
Well, please go on.
I mean, the fact that it was made by a major studio, of course, meant that it was played in that studio's theaters.
Right.
But I can't imagine that the public was terribly interested in this.
Yeah, well, this brings up this sort of interesting issue of... our view of Japanese film, the way in which there becomes a sort of canon of Japanese film from an American point of view, which is quite different from what the Japanese public's reception of its own cinema is.
Yeah, and many times culturally, an artist will circle back through another country. Like the French were the first to respond to Edgar Allan Poe,
right.
and we picked up Poe back from the French.
Right.
A number of great musicians, jazz musicians, you know, we picked up back from Europe and
right.
so forth. And one of the things that I found when I was working on Ozu and then when Don Ritchie did
right.
his book on Ozu, is that the Japanese. Got the young generation of Japanese
right.
got reinterested in Ozu through the American interest, because all they associated Ozu was those movies that their parents liked that they made them go to see and were so boring.
Yes. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And were all about they associated all old people's thinking old thinking
yeah.
you know. And then when they got back and looked at the films again, they realized it was much deeper than they remembered.
Yeah, that's. We should also just point out, I think, that since we're not showing one of the big Kurosawas mm-hmm. in this particular series,
yeah.
that it is Kurosawa himself, the best known of mm-hmm. all the directors, fits into that kind of phenomenon, because there was reticence on the part of his producers and distributors on sending Rashomon, mm-hmm. Arguably one of the three or four most famous of all Japanese films, to the Venice Film Festival, where it then won
yeah.
the grand prize and in many ways opened the gates internationally to the worldwide interest in Japanese film during this golden era of the
yeah.
50s and
yeah,
the 60s.
Well, I mean, you could talk about Japan endlessly and people have, but there are a couple truisms I think you can hang your hat on. One of them is, of course, that it's a consensus culture.
Right.
And another is that because they were the only country that was not colonized in the East, and because they were cut off so long and their culture inbred so long,
right.
that they still to some degree regard themselves as unique. And one of the things I learned when I lived there was that...
when you were making Mishima.
Yeah, I was there about a year. I realized that people were very uncomfortable with this idea that, this one world idea, that
yeah.
we're all sort of alike and we all have the same problems and loves and sorrows around the world. You know, that kind of universalism that you usually sells when, you,
right.
when you're off in another country. And it doesn't sell very well in Japan. They don't like to hear that. They don't like the idea that no one is like them. And one of the hard one of the tasks that had to be overcome in this century was the Japanese actually did not believe that anyone else could physically speak their language.
Yeah.
Didn't think they glottally, you could, no one but a Japanese could actually speak that language.
Right.
And so there's a strong residue of that. And in fact, they're a little more comfortable not being understood than being understood.
Because that sets limitations on the means of understanding.
Yeah.
And I mean,
my friend Don Ritchie, who I've known for many years, he said, you know, he always has these problems when he's on these panels because they regard him with far more suspicion than they do some guy that's just flown over because he's lived there so long. He came during the Second World War.
Right.
Has lived in the Japanese society, you know, for 50 years. He knows when they're lying. He knows when they're, you know, when they're speak, what level of the, you know, the language has 8 different levels.
Right.
And if you ask a question at one level and you get a yes back at a lower level, that's the same as a no.
Right.
You know. And so you know, he says, in fact, they're more uncomfortable with me than they are with some kind of tourist type mentality. You know.
Yeah, that deals with it. I'm curious. Many years ago, you're a kid from Michigan or whoever. How did you first encounter Japanese cinema? And you know, and then. You know, and then it develops all the way, into which you wrote a book on it, and you've done, you know.
What happened was that I was, you know, in college during the Vietnam War, and I have a brother who's 3 years older than me, and because we went to a seminary, there was always a possibility of a 4D deferment, so he decided to become a missionary, so he didn't have to go to Vietnam. So he went to the church and said, you know, I have the calling. And they had two...
To the Far East. Yeah.
Actually, they had 2 slots available, one in Tehran and one in Kyoto. And they flipped a coin, and he went to Kyoto. And so of such things, lives are made. And he ended up marrying a Japanese girl and living there.
Right.
And then he went through a kind of tough period in his life, and he fell upon watching gangster movies, Yakuza movies.
Okay.
And he wrote me a long letter about Yakuza movies, you know, the kind of thing people do when they're deeply depressed.
Yeah, yes. And they've got a lot of time on their hands with their depression, right?
Yeah. And I read this letter, and I said, this is a fabulous idea. And we wrote the script, and we sold it for a good deal of money, he went back to Japan. Eventually he came back to this country, and so that began my interest in traveling back and forth to Japan, and I've always then followed the story of Mishima at that time.
It
took me almost 6 or 7 years of negotiation with the estate to get the rights to do that.
Six or seven years of
yeah.
I'm curious as to whether you've in the year you were there, you actually want you to remind audiences that Mishima. There's a couple of things to remind them about it. First of all, if they haven't seen it, they should see it. Sorry to say, I have to recommend it on cassette, but that's the way the mop flops, as they say. But second, that it's a very unusual film, distinguished in many ways. One of which is you directed in Japanese, or at least you were directing actors who were speaking Japanese, because it's a mixed language film of English and.
No, it's all Japanese. I had Roy Scheider do the English, the narration also in English.
Okay.
Now, because it's never been shown in Japan,
there's no Japanese version.
Yeah, that's still in the mixing lab somewhere. Mishima. It's a hard kind of subject to start jumping into. He's a very controversial figure. About a man about whom the Japanese have not yet made up their mind, even though he's been dead 20 plus years.
Right.
Since they haven't made up their mind, they're not about to let someone else bring up the subject.
Yeah, the likes of you.
Yeah. And so you start out with that premise, and you add to the fact that the widow marshaled the Old Boy Network, which is basically the right-wing network, against the movie. and all of a sudden the movie didn't exist, you know, even though it was went to Cannes and won awards and so forth. And the financiers of the film, which is Fuji Television, Toho Toa, denied they financed the movie.
So,
you know, it's possible that for something just not to exist. You know, it doesn't.
I think we're back to this issue of silence and blankness. And,
yeah. If we all think about it hard enough, it will go away.
Well, I'm curious what the one of the things about the film. I mean, it's not only did you film it there; it's about a Japanese. But this film has an extremely rich Japanese feel to it. I mean, it shows you're completely conversant in those styles. How did you go about?
There were only I think three or four of us who spoke English in the whole production, so it was primarily a Japanese production, and I used a variety of styles. And one style was a straight knockoff from Naruse. Right. And another style was a highly theatrical thing, which really came from the Seibu School of Graphic Design, in which Eiko Ishioka did.
Yes, yes.
Yeah, who just got an Academy Award for her designs on Dracula.
Right.
And and then I had I had an old-time vet Toho production designer for some of the set pieces, and so we worked in the Japanese method.
Okay, but this is interesting because you're working in the Japanese method there in a moment in which is a studio method of working.
Yeah,
right?
and then those old antiquated studios, you know, dirt floors and unheated and all of that.
So you get to relive the production conditions of Ozu, etc. In that way.
Yeah.
This is very interesting because I don't know. There aren't many other people who've worked that far inside the Japanese film industry. And were you accepted while doing it, not afterwards? We've already.
Well, by the time I started making the movie, the widow had already started protesting.
Right.
Well, stirring up the pot. Right. And the producer, a Japanese man who raised the money, Mata Yamamoto, had to send his family out of the country because of death threats. And for a while there, I was wearing a kind of knife-proof vest when we were out on the streets. And then somebody said to me, "You don't really need to bother. You know, you're a gaijin, you're a foreigner, you're like a baby. You're not responsible for this terrible thing that's happening. We don't really blame you. You know, it's that producer,
you're the writer-director, but we don't blame you, right?
It's that producer of yours who got the money for you. He's a Japanese person. He should have known better." And
Paul, I can't believe I'm going to have to do this, but we're going to leave you as blameless on this because we've come to the end of our 30 minutes. Hold on just one second. If you'd like more information about Cinema Then, Cinema Now, or about cinema studies, drop us a line. Drop it to Cinema Then, Cinema Now, the College of Staten Island, Staten Island, New York, 10301. Let me give you that information again, okay? Drop it to Cinema Then, Cinema Now, the College of Staten Island, Staten Island, New York, 10301. Paul, I'm sorry to have cut you off. You know what this means. It means you've got to come back. Well, we're still on camera. We're still on camera. We've got to get you back sometime.
You know what I was going to say? I was shooting on the stage right next to Ichikawa-kan. And I was supposed to go over, and I had arranged to go over and see him for lunch. And I got a message that morning that I should not come over, that somebody had got to him.
Somebody had gotten to him that you were this dangerous.
And told him not to have the meeting.
So that's the anecdote, not about Ichikawa-kan, that you can tell because you didn't meet him because of this. Well, great way to wrap it up. As always, I hope that our thought and discussion here lead you to thought and discussion at home that you enjoy. Thanks for joining us.